Hi everyone, welcome. I am so glad that you are here on this sunny afternoon. This event is part of our Coping During COVID-19 series that the MMSD is putting on. Today we're going to be talking or addressing some of your concerns that you have shared specifically around the COVID-19 or coronavirus. We are planning on sharing just a basic overview of what COVID-19 is. We're going to talk a little bit about what you can do to stay healthy, as well as some prevention strategies. And then finally, we're going to talk about what you should do if you or your child might be having some symptoms and you're worried that you may have coronavirus. We are so looking forward to hearing from you guys. Please feel free to use the chat box to share any questions, concerns, or comments that you have. We're so glad that you're here. We're going to try to answer your questions kind of throughout as we go along, and hopefully we'll have time at the end to answer some more questions. My name is Carrie Stampfley. I am a pediatric nurse practitioner. I am a lead nurse with the Madison Metropolitan School District, and I help support all of the school nurses and school nursing assistants in our district. And today is a really special day because today is National School Nurse Day. And so I just want to give a huge shout out to all of the school nurses and the school nursing assistants that are joining us today and that are out there working during these really extraordinary times. School nurses and nursing assistants are such an essential part of our schools and a part of our healthcare system. And I am just so blessed and honored to work with so many great nurses and nursing assistants. So I am so happy that I'm joined today with Sarah Hughes. I'm going to let Sarah introduce herself and she'll get us started. Thanks.
Thanks, Carrie. Hi, everyone. Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
My name is Sarah Hughes. I work as a public health nurse at Public Health Madison in Dane County. And normally I work as the immunization coordinator when we're not in this time of dealing with COVID-19. I'm so excited to be joining you all today, especially excited that I get to join you on School Nurses Day. Happy School Nurses Day to all of you. I used to work as a school nurse prior to moving into public health, so I have a special spot in my heart for school nurses and the work that you do. I'm really excited about this opportunity to be able to share kind of what's going on from the public health perspective with coronavirus right now and how we're working in Dane County to keep you and your family and friends safe. Just another reminder that we would love to be able to answer as many questions as we're able to get to. So please put those questions in the comment box and we will get to as many as we're able to answer. I am going to kick us off first by talking a little bit about just what coronavirus or COVID-19 is, an understanding of who may be at high risk currently, and then what it's looking like right now in Dane County. So local numbers, what our cases are, kind of covering just an overview of coronavirus. So coronavirus or COVID-19 is an illness that's caused by a virus that can be spread to person to person. So just like influenza or the common cold, it's a virus that spreads amongst us all. What makes the COVID-19 virus unique is that it's new. So this is a new virus that has spread throughout the world over the last couple of months. COVID-19 symptoms can range from very mild or even asymptomatic. We found that people can have COVID-19 and not have any symptoms, to extremely severe and make people really sick. So some of those symptoms include cough, shortness of breath, fever over 100 degrees, headaches, chills, sore throat, runny nose, and then a new loss of taste or smell. So kind of a broad range of symptoms that we're talking about there. And some of those symptoms also can just be attributed to lots of other things too, like a cold or like seasonal allergies or things like that, which makes it a tricky thing to kind of pinpoint. So right now, it's important to remember that everyone is at risk for COVID-19. So if you're leaving your house, even to just go get groceries or go for a walk, it's important to remember that we're all at risk at this time. So people who may be at higher risk for developing more severe illness from COVID-19 would be older adults, and then anyone who may have a serious underlying medical condition. So those are the people that we want to encourage to really take extra precautions to make sure that you're protecting your health. So what does this look like in Dane County right now? So to date, Dane County has had 446 confirmed cases of coronavirus. So that means people who have gone and got tested and had a positive coronavirus test. Whereas in Wisconsin, we've had about 8,566 as cases as of yesterday. So because of all the hard work that you and your families are doing, Dane County is doing a really good job of flattening the curve, thanks to everyone's efforts at social distancing. So that means that we're starting to see cases kind of peak and level off. When we look at the total amount of tests done compared to the amount of positive tests that we see, that's how we can kind of look at how well we're doing as far as cases in Dane County. So over the last 2 weeks, Dane County has had an average percent positive. So out of all the tests that were done, how many were positive? Of 2%, while Wisconsin is currently sitting at 10%. So thank you for everyone that's been social distancing and staying home and protecting the health of our community, because we're seeing the fruit of those efforts. Dane County data also shows us that older adults are more likely to be hospitalized for COVID-19. So about 73% of people 70 years and older who have been diagnosed with COVID have been hospitalized, while 12% of people ages 20 to 49 have been hospitalized. So just to reiterate, we do know that the risk is higher for older individuals, and we are seeing higher hospitalization rates also for older individuals. And now I just want to put in a quick plug. So the Public Health Madison Dane County has been doing tons of great work. I work with amazing and really smart people who are looking into this data every single day and have put together a great data dashboard that you can look at every single day. It has updated case counts. You can look at the curve and see how we're doing. It shows how many people are hospitalized. All sorts of great data, and that's located on our website, which we'll make sure is available to you also. So I'm going to pop it over to Carrie, and she's going to take us into some overall health and well-being tips.
Thanks, Sarah. So, I think these are just really extraordinary times, and there's so much uncertainty. But the good news is there are some things that you can do to stay healthy and to protect yourself and your family. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about what those are and what those might look like for you. The first things I'm going to talk about are just some overall health and well-being tips. And the first one being making sure that you're sleeping well at night, which can be really, really challenging at times. But they do recommend between 7 and 9 hours of sleep per night for adults. And sleep is really, really important, because that is when your body heals and repairs the damage that you did from potentially the day previous. And so it's really a healing moment for your body. And so one of the best things that you can do is just really making sure that you're getting a good 7 to 9 hours of sleep at night. The next best thing to do is just be physically active, you know, and during these times, I think it's even more important that you get outside and get moving, not only for your physical well-being, but also for your mental well-being, just to get outside and feel the sun on your face and get moving. So keep doing those things, staying active, as well as eating a healthy diet and making sure that you're staying well hydrated. The other thing that we want to make sure that we talk about and encourage is that if you do have any chronic health issues that you had before the COVID-19 pandemic started, it is really, really important that you continue to take your prescribed medications and that you continue to talk and reach out to your healthcare providers, many of our healthcare providers are doing telehealth visits. And so it is really important that you continue to manage your chronic health conditions in the way that you were doing before COVID-19. And then finally, you know, anything that you can do for stress reduction and self-care during these times, I think I'd be really interested to see in the chat box what you all are doing to take care of yourself and to stay healthy during these uncertain times. I know for me, it is really important to get up early in the morning before anyone else is up, so my house is quiet and I can have a nice mindful cup of coffee. And then I try to get some physical activity in the morning and try to eat a healthy breakfast. So I feel like I at least started my day off as good as it could go. And maybe it doesn't stay that way for the whole day, but I gave it my best shot first thing in the morning. So those are just some general overall things that you can, that we recommend that you do to stay healthy. The next topic I'm going to talk about is hand washing, and hopefully all of our MMSD students came home and proudly showed you that they all knew how to wash their hands. We did a lot of education and outreach before schools were closed. So check in with your students and see if they remember how to effectively wash your hands. But if they don't remember, the best thing is that soap and water truly is the best way to do hand hygiene. Soap and water are not accessible, the next best thing would be to use hand sanitizer, and you want that to be at least of 70% isopropyl alcohol content. So again, soap and water, and so you're going to do it for 20 seconds, and the really important thing is that you just get all of your hands washed. So you want to make sure that you're scrubbing the tops of your hands, you're scrubbing in between your fingers, that you're getting your fingernails, and don't forget your thumbs. And so 20 seconds, they say sing happy birthday. That's a 20 second song. I will spare you me singing happy birthday for you. So when you want to wash your hands, obviously after blowing your nose or coughing or sneezing or using the restroom, really what is a great other additional thing to use and just to do even post COVID-19 is to make sure that everyone in your family is washing their hands before they are preparing or eating any meals or snacks. And then the two that have kind of came up more so since COVID-19 is making sure that you wash your hands after you go to the grocery store or are picking up medications or out in public, and after putting away your food, as well as pumping your gas. So that might be a great time to use hand sanitizer after you're pumping gas. So those are kind of the best things that you can do for hand washing. Then the next thing you've probably heard a whole lot about is face masks. And so the Center for Disease Control put out a recommendation that if you are gonna go out into public, that they want everyone to wear a cloth covering over their face. This is really to kind of protect everyone else. I think people don't realize how much sputum that you release when you're just talking, and even more so when you cough or sneeze. And so by wearing those cloth face coverings, you're really protecting everyone around you. So if everyone is wearing a cloth face mask, we're all protecting each other in this. The CDC has a great website on how to make cloth face coverings. They even have some that are like a no sewing technique, that where you don't need to sew. You can just use a t-shirt and some hair ties and make a face covering for that. So we'll post the CDC website so you can check that out and figure out how to make your face mask. I'm just curious how many of you have face masks and are out wearing them, and kind of what you're seeing when you're out and about in stores, and hopefully everyone has their face mask on. And then the next best thing, when you're home and you don't have a face mask on, if you do need to cough or sneeze, just make sure you're doing it in the crooks of your elbow, and then wash your hands really thoroughly after you cough or sneeze. The other thing that you've heard a lot about probably during COVID-19 is physical distancing. And so the recommendation is that you should have a minimum of 6 feet between you and other people who are not members of your household. So if you are going out into public, the minimum requirement is that there should be 6 feet of distance between you and others. There's been a lot of talk about, you know, you should really only leave your house for essential trips. And so that would mean if you need to go to the grocery store or go get gas or go to the doctor or pick up medications. But that doesn't mean that you have to stay actually in your house all day. We want you to get outside, be active. Governor Evers just opened up some of our state parks. So please go outside and stay active and really take care of yourself in that way if you're able to. The other thing that we've been getting a lot of questions about is cleaning and disinfecting. And there's a difference between the two. And so I just want to kind of explain what the difference is. So cleaning is usually when you're using soap and water and you're trying to visibly remove any surface dirt or grime. And some of that is effective in reducing some of the germs, but really to kill the COVID-19 or coronavirus, you need to use a disinfectant. And there's lots of different household disinfectants out there. So any household disinfectant is usually safe if it contains bleach in that product. So the main thing to know about that is that you really want to read the label on the household disinfectant, because it's going to tell you how to use that disinfectant properly. And it's going to tell you what the kill time is. And what that means is the amount of time that that product needs to stay on the surface so that it kills the majority of the virus or the bacteria. Most kill times are anywhere between 1 minute and 10 minutes. So really the most important thing with that is to make sure that you just read the label and follow the kill time. Now, the other thing is there's been lots of shortages. People have been buying lots of disinfectants, but the good news is you can make it yourself at home. You just need some bleach and some water and then something to put it in, maybe a bucket if you're doing a big cleaning project or a spray bottle for smaller activities. And we're going to post in the chat box the recipe that they recommend that you use so you get an appropriate ratio of bleach to water. And the kill time for that is you need to make sure that it's on for at least a minute. So check out our chat box for that recipe. If things that you want to clean and disinfect daily would be very frequently used surfaces. So that would be like light switches, doorknobs, sinks and faucets and handles and toilet fixtures, maybe your keyboard or your phone. So those are things that we really recommend that you disinfect daily in your home. Now, if you have somebody who you think may have COVID-19 in your home or test positive for COVID-19, there are many, many more cleaning and disinfecting and isolation protocols that you should follow with that. And I strongly encourage that you either check out the Center for Disease Control site on what to do if you have a family member that is infected, and Public Health Madison-Dane County also has a link on their website on what to do for that. So just know that if you have somebody in your family that is positive, that there are additional cleaning and disinfecting and isolation for precautions that you need to take. The final thing that I'm going to talk about is a lot of people have had questions about how to safely shop for food, groceries, and necessities. And, you know, the main thing, we're very lucky in Madison that many, many of our grocery stores offer the ability to order online and do either curbside pickup or delivery to your doorstep. But if you're not able to use those, these are some recommended steps that we advise that you take before you go grocery shopping or when you're grocery shopping. Well, the first thing is you just want to make sure that you have a really good list, and so that you are the most efficient that you can be while you're in the store, so that you know exactly what you need to get and how quickly to get it. Make sure that you're wearing your mask or your cloth face covering, and then make sure your shopping cart or your basket has been disinfected. Most stores have somebody that's already there wiping down the shopping carts and baskets before you come in to shop. Some stores have products there that you can use for yourself, or you could bring your own and wipe down your cart or your shopping basket. And then I think one of the hardest things is we don't realize how much we touch our face throughout the day. So our eyes, nose, and mouth are really the areas that you try want to not touch. And so when you're in doing that shopping and out in public settings, you really want to avoid touching that. And I also tell people, put your phone away, because it's really easy. You'll get stuff on your hands and then you're touching your phone. And so put your phone away or put your earbuds in so that you can have hands-free conversation while you're shopping. And then a lot of stores have arrows marking the direction they want you to go down certain aisles. Really practice good physical distancing. So there should be a minimum of 6 feet between you and other shoppers while you're in the grocery store. And then when you're done grocery shopping, just make sure you wash your hands. And then we recommend that you wash your hands after you put away your groceries. And so those are really the things that you can do to kind of keep yourself healthy, safe, and protect your family. Now, Sarah's going to talk a little bit about what to do if you think that you might have COVID-19. Thanks.
Thanks, Carrie. So yeah, I'm going to talk a little bit about what to do if you're feeling sick, how you can access healthcare, talking to your doctor about your symptoms, and what COVID-19 testing currently looks like for us. So if you're feeling sick, if you're experiencing any of those symptoms that I talked about before, the cough, shortness of breath, fever, body aches, chills, runny nose, new loss of taste or smell, we want you to stay home first. So isolate yourself at home and then call your healthcare provider. So all the local healthcare systems in Dane County have numbers listed on their website that you can call and figure out what the next steps are to do about your symptoms. So most of the healthcare providers are going to do some sort of telehealth visit with you where you'll talk with someone about your symptoms, how long you've had them, if you've had any travel recently, if you've been in contact with anyone else that you know is sick. You'll talk about that with someone over the phone, and then they'll determine if you should get tested or not. So based on your symptoms, they'll determine if you need testing, and then they'll tell you where to go for that testing. So right now, the Wisconsin Department of Health Services and the CDC recommends testing for anyone that has COVID symptoms, even mild symptoms. And that's great. That's what we want. And Wisconsin has drastically increased our capacity to test more and more people over the last weeks and months. However, supplies still are limited in some parts of the state and within some communities, and depending on the day and the week, there's still some supply chain issues to get hospitals and clinics the testing supplies that they need. So your individual healthcare provider will determine if you need testing and where to go for testing. So us at Public Health, we are working with the state health department and with our community partners and our community healthcare systems also to develop plans of how we can have long-term sustainable testing within our community. So stay tuned for that. That's something that's really important to us at Public Health. We know that it's important when we think about how we're going to beat coronavirus long-term. So our healthcare systems have done a great job of increasing their capacity to test more and more people. And we're going to continue to work on that to figure out how we can make that a sustainable process as the months go on. So if you are feeling sick, you talk to your doctor, your healthcare provider, you go in and get tested for coronavirus. And then if you do end up testing positive, a public health nurse, so someone like me, many of my colleagues that are nurses at the health department, will give you a call and talk to you about next steps and what happens next. So they'll tell you everything you need to know about isolating at home, how long you need to stay isolated at home, what you should do about your family members. They'll talk to you about anyone else that you may have been in contact with. So you've probably heard a lot about contact tracing when we talk about coronavirus. And that means that public health professionals are going to be looking at trying to trace everyone that someone who's tested positive has come in contact with. And that's a key thing in order for us to keep this this disease contained, and we can tell those people to isolate and get tested if necessary. So that's something that a public health nurse would be talking to you about your symptoms, what to do if you need additional care. So if you need to go to the hospital to get some additional care, or what that would look like. So our website, again, has tons of great information on it, all frequently asked questions, resources, and things of what you should do if you're feeling sick and you feel like you need testing. Lots of great stuff. There are also resources that about food and housing and all sorts of things that we also know are impacted by this pandemic as well. So would encourage you to go to our website to check out more there. And then also the CDC's website and the Wisconsin Department of Health Services website as well has lots of great information that will answer a lot of those questions. So I think we're going to jump into answering some of your questions now that have been coming in. Thank you so much for asking questions. We encourage you to send more if things have come up that you have questions about. So one that I saw come in here is, can the virus be transferred through air exchanges in buildings? So I think that question is asking about, like, you know, if you're in a large office building, is that something that, or in an apartment building, or where there's maybe multiple floors or lots of people, do we need to worry about the virus coming in through the air vents or being spread throughout the building that way? And so there's lots of research being done right now on if coronavirus is transferred via droplets or via airborne. So meaning, is it something that droplet would be someone coughs and then the virus is in those particles that they're coughing that might be on a doorknob, and then I touch the doorknob and then maybe touch my face or my eyes, and that would be how I would get the coronavirus then. Whereas airborne would be more of the someone else around me has the disease, has the virus, and can I just breathe it in because I'm in the same vicinity as them or the same building as them? So there's been the CDC and other organizations have been doing lots of research on that, and they're still continuing to do lots of research on that. But for now, I would say that no, it can't be spread through the air exchanges in large buildings. It's really within that close contact, that 6 feet, which is why we when we talk about social distancing, we talk about that 6 feet of distance that we want to see between each other. So not something that you need to worry about as far as it being spread throughout a building via the air exchanges.
One of the other questions we had was, somebody asked if we could speak to outdoor social gatherings. And right now, those are really strongly discouraged. And really, the only people you should be hanging out with are the people that are in your house. And so, unfortunately, for those of us that have small kids, it's so hard. So that means no play dates, no group sporting events, no hanging out with neighbors, and things like that. Right now, it's really meant to, you know, be in your home, get outside to get active with your household, family members. But really, you should not be having any type of social gatherings outdoors until the restrictions get lifted. And then they will tell you, there's usually an advisement of how many people you can be around for a social gathering. And at this point in time, they're really recommending that you not have any social gatherings, so no play dates with anyone outside of your household. And if you look at our numbers, it's really, really working. The physical distancing that we've done and the measures that we've had in place, people in Madison are doing an amazing job, and we really have the numbers to show that it is working for us.
Yeah, there's another question here, similar to the one that I had answered about kind of how the virus spreads. Someone asked if, so for someone who's immunosuppressed, is it okay for that person to ride in the car without a mask with the windows rolled down? And I would say, Yes. I don't think there is a risk of the fresh air coming in through the car. If anything, I think the fresh air is a good thing, and being outside and getting the fresh air, especially when you're driving in a car and through the car window, is a good thing. As long as the other person or people that you're in the car with are the people that you've been social distancing with, and it's not someone that you would need to be worried about wearing a mask around. So yes, I think it's fine for someone who may be immunosuppressed to be riding in the car with the windows down without a mask on, especially if the car is moving and you're not stopped for long periods of time.
Sarah, there's a question on here that says, how long does it take to get test results? Do you want to speak to that one?
Sure. So unfortunately, this is not a straightforward answer that I can give you. So there's several different labs that tests are being sent to, and the turnaround time can kind of vary based on the lab of where your test is sent. So I've heard some tests can be turned around in as quickly as a couple hours, whereas other labs, depending on where it is and what's happening, it might be several days. We've seen a great improvement in this since we started with this back in March. When we first started testing more, the turnaround time was up to a week that we were seeing with lab results. But now it should be within a couple hours to a couple days for the majority of the laboratories that tests in Dane County are being sent to.
Just looking, if you have any other questions, please put them in the chat box and we're happy to try to answer them. I am seeing some questions about what it's going to look like for MMSD in the fall, and we are all kind of wondering that question. We do have a group of people that are working on it, as is the CDC and DHS and DPI. Everyone is really trying to think about what it's going to look like in the fall. Probably the only thing I can tell you is that there is going to be changes, and school is probably going to look and feel a little bit differently than it did before we had the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, what exactly that's going to look like, I'm not exactly sure, but we are currently in the process for planning of reopening schools and what that might look like and how we can do that safely. And we're partnering with our public health experts to really help guide us, and our local health experts to really make sure that we're doing the right thing for our staff and for our students and for our families.
I see there's also a question about thoughts on summer camps and what's feasible, what can we expect for the summer. This is something that we are getting asked a lot about at Public Health. Everyone kind of wants to know about what it's going to look like for the rest of the summer. Can my kids go to camp? When can I send my kids back to daycare? When can I go back to work safely? Those are all really valid questions that I think everyone has. And I'll start by saying that the data leads our decision making from a public health perspective. So the numbers and the data and the cases are going to continue to influence those decisions of what our summer and our fall can look like, the same as of what school will look like in the fall as well. So we will continue at Public Health to closely watch the data and to see where our numbers are in Dane County. And I don't think I can give a concrete answer about what summer camps might look like for the fall or for the summer, I'm sorry, or what maybe you had a graduation party or something else planned for this summer. That we really can't look more far ahead than the next couple weeks to say that we know what the data is showing us through the end of May and what Governor Evers and the state are recommending through the end of May. And then after that, we'll hopefully be able to slowly phase in more things in a way that can keep everyone safe.
There's a question about summer school, and as far as I know, there hasn't been any final decision about what summer school may look like for Madison School District. We're still trying to get some guidance from DHS and DPI on what summer school may or may not look like for MMSD. For right now, we do know at this point in time, we are closed until the end of the school year.
I saw someone had asked about raw or fresh meat carrying or supporting the virus. And so this, I would recommend, just like you follow for any of your other grocery items that you're getting. I don't think there's any evidence to show us that we have right now that says that raw beef or whatever it might be, or any type of meat can carry the virus, where if you would eat it, you would get sick. But it's just like any other item from the grocery store, any item that you would pick up and touch. We want to make sure we're washing our hands well before preparing food, wiping down packaging when you bring it back from the grocery store, those sorts of things. So following the same food safety protocols that you would, regardless of if you are worried about coronavirus or not. And then also now that we're the things we're doing now when we get back home from the grocery store, and then cooking your meat in a safe way as you would before.
Thank you for all the questions. This is great. I am so glad that you guys are all here. Just scrolling through, there's one about taking ACE inhibitors and blood pressure meds and if that's a factor. And there's a lot of research that is happening. And this is the one thing I can tell you, like there is so much information coming out on a daily basis. They're researching and trying to figure this out. They do know that there is some ACE2 inhibitor component to coronavirus or the COVID-19. It's just, nobody's quite sure what exactly that plays and what does that mean for your risk factors. So if you have a chronic health condition, I strongly encourage that you, one, continue your medications, but then check in with your healthcare provider to have a conversation about, you know, what does this mean for me personally with my personal chronic health condition and what puts me at risk, and have that discussion with your provider. And then I would assume that if anything new came out where they're showing a strong correlation, it will be all over the news. And perhaps we'll do another Facebook Live event so that we can share that new information with you all.
And there's a question about, and I think we have time maybe for one or two more, so we'll see what we can answer here. But there's a question about wearing a mask when outside, like if you're walking, biking, or running. And to answer this question, again, like Carrie just said, things are changing so, so quickly with this. We're living through something where we're kind of figuring it out as we go. The scientists and researchers are figuring it out as we go. Healthcare professionals, public health professionals, and things change so, so rapidly from day to day. So caveat with everything that we're saying here is that this is something that may evolve as we learn more as well. But as far as wearing a mask when you're outside, I would keep in mind how closely you may be to other people. If you're going walking in an area that is going to be really crowded, for let's say, or on a bike path where you're going to be encountering lots of other people in close proximity, then you might want to think about wearing a mask. But if you're out riding a bike or going for a run or a walk, and you're not anticipating coming within 6 feet of very many people, or you'll just be passing people very briefly, then I would say no, you don't need to wear a mask when you're exercising outdoors.
Well, thank you so much, everyone. We are out of time for today. Thank you so much for coming and joining with us. I'd just like to invite you all as well next week. They are going to continue the Coping During COVID-19 series with a topic around financial wellness. And so we thank you again so much for coming and joining us today. And I hope you all stay healthy and well and find some time to get outside and enjoy the sun. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.